Well, Tony doesn't have the expertise. He's just far too redneck to fix this sector shaft. So he sent me over here to Ray Talbot, Talbot's machine. We've just met. Well, Ray.
Hey, good to see you, Jeff.
As a matter of fact, there's other things that Tony can't handle, isn't there?
Oh, yeah, sir.
And you got one right there. Well, what do you got?
I'm building a center portion of a, well, I can't speak very good because of my stroke I had, but it's a Rolls-Royce engine water pump driving pledge. That's what I'm putting together right now. This is the sample product. Originally, I got it into a large piece of steel from this time, and then I put it in to bring it down to it somewhere near Chase until I can now begin to start completing the actual sides on it. And we'll have to drill and put threads in the tap, the bolts, to put it in plane, the same as we have on this one. So everything, when we complete a new one, will be basically number one, just like the original one, when it's all completed. So that's where we're at today. I'm just finally got a good drawer that I can make some numbers and pictures. So now I can put numbers on it. So the next time you ask for one, I don't have to have the same one anymore. I can create an original.
Just make about 10 of them at once, and then you have to.
Well, that's why I'm doing two of them at a time, because he wants to get on the internet so he can go anywhere around the world to find these two, because there aren't many of them around. So he can now buy them from me and send them across the world.
Yeah.
So that's.
But the thing is, like guys like you and Tony, mm-hmm. we ain't going to have you much longer.
That's right. I'm 72, and goodness knows it's very hard to find us.
Yeah.
We need to find little places, because we don't want to be out there pushing the button and catches the part. Push the button and catch the part. Doesn't work. I've been there. I owned my machine shop for 33 years. So I ran about 20 years on those three machines where I push the button and catch the part. But I could usually, with something like this, after I've put in the numbers in place, I could increase six of these for every one a man could do at once,
yeah.
or more.
Efficiency. Okay, so here's what we're dealing with.
Yes, sir, I see.
This is a mess, and this is what it's supposed to look like.
And that's a piece of cake.
Yeah, but the issue on it. Okay, I'll agree to that. See the issue on this one?
Yes, I see it.
Okay, so this, and that's formed.
Yes.
So it's junk.
It's junk already.
So there you are.
I will hold it on my machine, and I will support it here. Everything here will run concentric with this shaft through extended out in this area, so that when I can turn it on the machine true, everything here now will be running smooth.
Okay.
Right here.
We don't get to see you do it.
It's not been damaged. I can show you. I'm explaining to you.
Oh, okay.
I don't have everything set for the machine because I didn't know exactly what I'm going to be doing. But we will line everything up here with a rest or word. It's a press. It holds it, supports it right here. Now this will run true. Then I'll normally find out what the threads would require.
The pitch?
16 pitch or whatever pitch it is. And I'll have to set my machine up accordingly to that size. Once I get that engaged, so it would cut right across at this part back here that's already clean yet.
Yeah.
Then I can set my machine over and move it manually side by side until it gets right over a nice clean spot. Now I will move my tool in manually over a nice white clear area after I clean this up. And then I can move the tool exactly in the right position with the good portion of what's left on the machine. So now I can move this back. I can take any bumps off of here so it holds the size to measure
the OD,
the full diameter.
Right. Yeah.
Then I can begin up here on the normal thing, and I'll back it out on my angle tool just as I would normally, and I will cut right down the back side, pardon me, the front side of the angle on the thread, and I'll follow it right down as I cut until I bring this portion the same shape as here. So now everything runs originally with the original portion. I'll probably also put a new sharp end in here to make it make a nice
square that off a little bit.
Nice end on it so that it looks like
a little more like that new one.
Yeah. So that when you get done, you're going to have a nice center hole in the corner, as well as a nicely smooth chamfered off thread, so that everything should screw just like a new one.
And it, and they won't know that somebody beat on it with a framing
hammer. Well, the only thing they'll find different is that this one is going to be a tiny bit smaller than the other one.
Yeah, there's enough. There's just enough there to fix this.
Yeah, that'll give you plenty of material then to clean it up.
Okay, so let's start.
That's it. Well, we'll
so we need to determine if this thing's bent, right?
That's correct, yes. I need to determine if this one...
Because we can't get the run out to go away on the lathe.
That's right. That's correct. Okay, the highest place on it right now is at zero. I'll make sure of that as I go through here. Okay, we're pretty much at zero there. And I just want to determine if it's going to... It says we're a little bit... There, it's a little out of it. Okay, I'm going to move also over, way over here.
Where do we stand here? Are we looking good? Or
right now it looks like we're running around 3/1000ths of run out, but when I put it on the support over there that sets here, that will station this solid. So everything that moves from here over is going to be run pretty much dead on. It still may run out here a tiny bit, but it won't be a problem.
Okay.
So, yeah.
So this shows you what you're up against.
It just gives me an idea what I'm going to be working with as I machine it, yes.
Okay.
Now we're going to put this in. We're going to bring over just a little there. And what I'm going to station at, this is a stationary position on here.
There's got to be a name for those little things, right?
Yes, there is. One's a steady rest, and this is a steady rest. There's a follower rest that goes on here. Six of them, or three of them here. This is a steady wrist, and the other one, which you're not going to see, and right at the inside of the box here, get me the drill, not the drill, the oil can, the squirt can. Just lift it up. See, so I got the oil in there and the drill in there combined.
I don't see that drill there. Why? No, as a matter of fact,
that's
I don't.
Exactly right.
You already chucked that hard in the lathe.
Yes, it's in hard.
But you didn't turn it on to see if there's any run out.
I'm not worried about it now. Because the machine, as I assemble it and tighten it at the time, it brings it within 2/3 It will definitely not be a problem. Even if I pushed it down 3/1000ths below here, it won't hurt. Because of the taper on there would be so small amount different from out here to back here, you'd never notice it. Now, if I put it in at this angle, of course, it wouldn't work very well.
I know, but yeah. It just seems that, you know, just sticking it in there and tightening the jaws down on the chuck, it could be off in any direction.
Yeah, it could. If I didn't know my machine, it certainly would, yeah. That's why I spent a $500 check here.
Makes you want to have little speed handles on them.
Yeah, would be nice, but that's why we don't make enough money to work, so if we run it slow and have more money.
We're by the hour here.
We get $45 an hour, sir.
That's not a problem.
That's very inexpensive for that, considering I have 55 years of experience. That's less than a dollar a year.
You ever see those? I always think it's the stupidest thing where we had 120 combined years in the carpet business or whatever it happens.
Sure do, yes they do. This is our eyeballs.
So your silhouette.
These are eyeballs, that's correct. You set that in somewhere that makes it look something better.
Give you some contrast.
Yes. And I can usually pull it down to within about 2 or 3 thousandths of an inch at that position. And it determines whether I'm close or whether I'm nowhere near.
So you're looking at the gap between the post and the shaft.
That's correct. That's exactly what I'm doing. So now we'll put a tiny little drop. And that's all we need right now.
Roll it and snug it, roll it and snug it. Now it can't go anywhere but true.
Can't go anywhere but where it was. You'll put that back where you
want. I shall.
Thank you very much.
I ain't taking the blame for that one though.
Okay. I'm now checking the gauge and it's 14 pitch.
Okay.
Gauge. So now I have to make certain that my gears will make at the proper dimension. I'm running 15.
Oh, wait a minute.
Excuse me, 14 and 63. As you see, A and B would be 60 for A. 63 is the B position on a standard 120-tooth gear. And we will then locate in relation to this number 14. That'll give us 14 with these letters B and D down below. And that's how we determine where to set the tool to cut. So now I have to do exactly what you can take it right here in a moment. I just have
yeah.
to. So now I have to exchange, move this out of the way so that I can pull this tool out, which is the screw pitch that determines how fast the tool will cut the correct pitch on the part that I'm working with. Now I can move that out of the way, I hope. Looks like I got one more to move. Got to move that baby out. There. Now my gauge. This one says 60 threads. I'm replacing that with
63.
That will go on here. Identically the same. Only it now has the balance of everything put back in shape. Now I have to bring everything back up into position and snug it up a little bit so that as I bring it in place, the teeth will mesh with both pieces on the inside. Let's see, this is I believe this is 160. I better make sure on this. I'm sorry. I got to pull that. Make sure
that 120 on there.
At the 110. I think the other one may be 128.3, which is the larger. 127 is the biggest one. Yes, I am on the correct one. I was just making sure. I didn't want to go in there and start cutting the wrong threads already.
Then you'd have to make me a nut for free.
Yeah, I could do that too, but I didn't want to.
In 7th grade in industrial arts, we had to make the jars that held the screws. A little rack, it had 9 jars on it.
Okay, yeah.
Rotating mm-hmm. rack.
Yes.
And you had to do the angle iron and cut the angle iron and form and bend the frame for the rack and then... Uh-huh. Box, pan, and brake, and solder, and
oh yeah,
and wow. And read the print,
mm-hmm.
and invariably, quite a few people in the class, including myself, would tap the threads on the end uh-huh. at 1/4-20.
Oh yeah,
but the blueprint said 1/4-24.
Okay.
And
so you got
you had supplied 1/4-24 threads, nuts,
So if you cut them to 1/4-20, you had to make your own nuts.
I gave them an extra piece. Give them a little extra work. I'm just going to knock the bumps off of the old deal where you round it off. Make sure that it will be running at about, this is at 400 revolutions per minute. Maybe I'll back away to around 300 on this one, so it's not quite so bumpy. And I will bring back here, and I'm going to say this is what the OD of your mouth is there.
Okay.
Now I can get away from there, and I can go over here and leave this there. Machined presently about 20 thousandths above the total diameter before I machine where he had ground away from it before. We'll bring it back to the natural size of the part so that we have a completed finish diameter when we machine it. We'll do that kind of slow at the low so that it doesn't tend to push things out with a bigger amount of material. Starts with a T, but not trust on any of them. The pitch diameter is when this measures one to the bottom and one to the outer edge, one in the groove and one on the outside. So that would make it halfway in the middle.
Okay.
It'd be from the high to
and
the
that
low.
That would be your pitch diameter.
That would be called okay. Pitch diameter. That's correct. Now we are reading at 827 thousandths diameter. Is the pitch diameter of the threads.
Okay.
We will work for that, and I'll just measure at the back portion on there, give it a complication to see if it's the same or similar, where it's in the back where it wasn't beat up.
Right.
Okay.
Where we still have good threads.
Correct. While we're still using it, we're using it as a comparison here on the, and see if they did a good job.
GM?
Yeah.
Saginaw?
Yeah. Torn. It's 25 inches.
25?
Instead of 26, it's 25,000. Yeah. So it's pretty close, I would say.
You're playing with tools again. Oh, that's right. You have to engage the worm.
Yes. This is the lead screw.
Lead screw, okay.
This is the lead screw, and it's used with a half nut. The half nut grabs on the outside of the lead screw and it follows along. And it will move much like it is there. I'll reject it now.
I'm ready.
Now I'm aligning the tool in position. I can see it's moving. Now I'm stopped. That's as if it were cutting the screw. Now I need to bring the diameter on my paper below so that when I align my tool I get the same position. So when I bring this point together now and I draw these in to get almost a dead picture all the way across till I can get all the way down both sides on my tool being in the same shape. It's very close. It's almost identical. It looks like it might be a tiny bit out on this position here. We'll just move everything out here because now everything there will be locating what we're working off of. I'll slow this a little further as well so that we can work into the corner. Okay. All right, now we're waiting for the dial to line up with the alignment. And I'm going to bring this in. Yes, we have about 60 thousandths of an inch. So once I get through, now I can back this off, keep it right there. And we're going through here all the way through that way. We'll continue to follow. So you can see it, now I'm bringing this into position zero, and I'll move in a small amount, and we'll wait till that zero comes up again, turn to one. Now, as you can look, you can see we're beginning to cut through part of the used portion that we machined.
The smashing.
Right, the part that's been smashed. So we will clean all of that out as we get to the final end, which I may even move a little slower. I have to wait for the next zero again. And now you'll be able to see it go across there. See it cutting through there? Skipping, 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 skipping. Then I cut it out. And I bring it back to zero. And I move again, further in. Back out here, because I'll just back it off and then I don't have to stand and watch it so long. I can talk for free this way. Make more money doing this way. Cut, 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 cut. Now it's not cutting anymore because we're still in the threaded position. It stops cutting, then I can back the tool back out before I stop everything, which would make a groove all the way around the part. So we don't want it to be there. We want to back it clear so we can move in there nice and smooth.
How much are you taking off per pass?
Presently I'm taking 5 thousandths diameter on the diameter. When you're cutting that hole very small for a short distance where you're going to come at the end, you got to pull everything all at the same time. Otherwise, it will make a mess all over. Always using it as zero each time. Back to my 1-inch dial, so I always make sure I play in the same place. In case for some reason something different, then it'll always follow to the original dial.
Return to the same start point.
It always comes in the same place, absolutely time. We're getting kind of close. We're down to about 10 thousandths of an inch left to get to the original size. And we should be pretty close. It'll have knocked some bumps out of it, and some grooves out of it, and things like that. I usually probably run around 3 thousandths for the last one. And then I'll bump, 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 cut that corner off to get a nice little bevel, and I'll go through with a clean one and make sure no burrs into the one I'm cutting for a sharp edge on the corner for you. Sorry. ain't right, not here right now. Hello. You didn't know what you wanted, stupid. Shut up. Get them stinking people calling you all hours of the day and night. We'd like to tell you, you can make $10,000 a day, a week, or something in their butt. And none of them ever talking, and you can never call them back because they don't even have telephone.
So you clean them up all the way down to the end?
Yep, all the way right into the other. Now we're going to kind of do a few little bumps here along the edge until we get a clean up.
So it doesn't look like a framing hammer anymore?
Yeah, that's correct. Some of the bumps are probably would be sufficient if, unless you want it smooth.
Well, I want to take the ugliness off of it.
Okay, then I'll take it all away. See right there, it's sticking a few of them.
Yep.
But not all of them.
So you're just putting your chamfer on it now, and then you come back and make a flat pass across the front.
And not only that, but after I make my flat here, then I'll go back in with a zero clearance once again to make sure I any burr that I'm pushing in right now, I don't make a nice burr down inside over here. And we're still not quite there yet.
Well, I think I would just leave that and then go ahead and do the flat.
All right. Spot and then on. I'm going to bring this in now to my...
I don't think the judges are going to look at that. However, thousands of people will be seeing it on YouTube.
Okay, now we're going right back through the original groove. Taking the last little bits off of it. Now we've got it all cleaned up. None of those burrs I just made on the end are gone. And I'll come out here.
About this?
Yeah.
Hey, I like to go.
Yeah, now we're just going to come across and get the teeth off. Now, you see, we got pretty close to what you'd like, would you say, or would you want me to go?
I would say that's all we need.
Okay, and I will do my best to clean up the center rim. That looks about the right size.
So you chose the thicker bit so that the hole wouldn't bend the bit.
Right, it wouldn't bend the bit, but it also, by moving it up here, put a little extra force on it. I don't care if I'm pushing it down a half a tenth or thousand, because this is just going to be boring its way in.
Yeah, it's just the dimple for the puller. Right. Well, it's actually a dimple from the machining process, but...
Yes, it's actually a center screw. It's coming up pretty well. Now we've got the hole bored out. Looks like you have a good center in it.
Looks like nothing ever happened to it.
I think we've repaired the problem.
I believe so.
And as you can see, it's quite easy to get it out. We could put the next one in and the next one because now everything's already set.
At $45 an hour.
Yes. So, there is our first product. And this is what you got. If I had a screw or, a
nut?
A blow.
Oh, a blow gun?
I guess it's not on, it's over there. Maybe I don't
know. I think you took care of it. Yeah, see?
Give it a whisker disc. And there you go.
We are on the road with Charles Carroll.
And that's the importance of having all of the tools to make all of the machines do all of the things. Because if you don't have them, you can't do that.
Most excellent, Mr. Talbot.
Yes, sir.
I thank you very much.
My pleasure. And, $300, was it?
Yeah, I think somewhere on there.
Now, three.
And since I don't have my wallet, you're going to hold my cameras hostage while I go home and get the money.
Well, you can buy this way anywhere soon. You know what it is.
Okay, back to the assembly procedure. Get a smashed sector shaft.
Neck shifter snap.
Yep, no M.
Okay. So you need to fix.
Okay, this is where we stop and I move the camera.
Okay.
I would use the second camera, but the battery's dead on
that
one.
That's quite all right. With and still make it really understanding made so you can understand it too. So there are words that I'll just have to say another word. And maybe that doesn't actually. I got a friend that came over there near Tony's place and he brings his guns in here, there's a $300 one broken.
Oh! Add that to the bill.
No, it is.
It wasn't put away in the right spot.
Well, I gave you good instructions.
Is there any chance we can turn the fan off?
Yeah, if you want to get sweat on your camera, I don't care.
As long as you're comfortable with it.
We can go to low.
Because all you can hear is the fan.
Oh, okay.
Lay it back.
Whew. Missed the hole, thank goodness.
Oh, by the hour.
I know. You'd be burying down there for an hour trying to find this tree under that one for $45. Didn't do yesterday when I was turning this at 700 revolutions. And I was using a V-shaped angle, cutting down there. Well, in the process, some of the stringers that come out of there might be this long.
Yeah.
If I was in a bigger chuck here, and they would bite in one of these pieces here, along here, and that hits 7 times per second. Yeah. 760, and there's 3 times that is 300 and whatever. That's how many pieces are going by. Wherever it's cut.
Give you a whipping.
Yeah. And it doesn't matter. Oh, goodness me. I did something I shouldn't have. I have to start a little bit because I didn't start in a position here. So I'll have to start another and I'll just set it at 1. So I beg your pardon. Now you get to see how it's done as a practice. You now got me in there, that's 1 time around. You got me in here 1 time, so that's 2 times.
Oh, right? I see. Every time I play you back, I have to give you a royalty.
That's right, Roy. And I don't mind $10.
Yeah. Every time. Wish I got $10 every time.
Yeah.